let me take few minutes to share with you what is happening in the world today with regards to agriculture and how pandemic has changed the entire agriculture canvas. In fact, probably in the days to come, we may be referring to agriculture before pandemic and after pandemic. Few changes have come. Just to mention an example, during the pandemic, since everybody was interested or concerned about the immunity aspect, we at university and the horticulture department in the state were concerned with the farmers of sweet orange and mango. So they were in a very bad situation. So we thought that how to help them. So the government of Telangana has made an appeal that by consuming more fruits, then the immunity buildup will take place. So immediately we have innovated how to connect the farmers directly to the consumers. So intermediaries have disappeared, and through postal department, we have handled the entire produce from the farmers directly to the consumers. So you can see how crisis provides us an choice and opportunities. It was rightly said by John F. Kennedy that whenever there is a crisis, you have an opportunity and you also have a choice. So this is how the situation what we are today. Yeah. Now you can see, though people talk in several ways, but if you look at the Indian agriculture, I can categorically say that it is unparalleled in the history of any country. It is a success story. Now you can see the value of agricultural output, how it has grown since 2000 to 2017. So the saying of ship to mouth, which we actually at the time of independence, unless food grains come from USA, we were not in a situation to have the adequate food grains to our population. So thanks to the Green Revolution, we are today food secure and we are in a position to export to other countries as well. So Indian agriculture can be considered as a success story. However, along with that, we had some, say what you call problems that have encountered with regards to resources which are declining today. So that needs to be taken care of with the emerging technologies. Next. Now you can see these are the challenges that we have today globally as well as in the country. The first and foremost is that the population, which is about 1.37 today, will be touching 1.7 billion by 2050. So, and at the same time, you can also see that the rural population is rapidly migrating to the urban centers. However, now we have to see what statistic we will be getting with this pandemic, because we have seen that most of the urban population has just started reverse migration to rural areas. So that needs to be seen how it shapes into in the days to come. And another most important say what you call resource, that is water, is declining rapidly, and there is a competition. Even Niti Aayog has, in the last year's report, they have mentioned that the nearly 60% of the rice area and wheat area is under water scarce situation. So this is an important aspect which need to factor in our research and extension as well as the education. Now there is another aspect which is very disturbing. That is, we are producing, say what you call, nearly all put together, food grains, horticultural commodities, milk, sugar, and all put together, we are producing something like 800 million tons of agricultural commodities. But the food waste is also huge. There is about nearly 30 to 36% of the wastage taking place. That needs to be taken care of. So food waste, the decline, the arresting the food waste means, so what you call produce, you have the reserves of the food. So that needs to be looked at. Then vulnerability to climate change, I need not tell you in the recent past how floods have taken place, recurrent droughts, rainfall, change in the rainfall pattern. So now today in the country, there is a public discourse. People are looking at how we have to address these issues. so that how we can move forward. So the objective is only produce more with less. Next. Then another important aspect that is taking shape is that today, if you look at the consumer, he is spending nearly 57% of his expenditure as per the 2016 statistics. Nearly 57% of his expenditure is only on dairy products, eggs and fruits and vegetables. And if you add cereals to it, so then it will be something like, say what you call 76%. Under these three commodities, say what you call the consumer is spending. Now this gives us an indication where to emphasize and what should be done so that the crop diversification, crop plus livestock diversification, these are the things which we have to look at in the future to bring in stability both temporally and as well as spatially, and also to bring in income revolution. We were discussing all the time about green revolution, white revolution, blue revolution, but now there is a need that we have to think of income revolution to the farmers. Next. Now this is another important aspect. As I said, that say what you call always a crisis provides us an opportunity and choice. You can see our productivity levels in the country are less than even our peers in Asian countries, and as well as if you compare with the world. So there is a lot of opportunity, incremental opportunity for enhancing oil seeds, fruits and vegetables in the days to come. So this is where we have to put our efforts. Now today, if we can summarize the challenges what we have, there is a low efficiency in production. Production costs are rising. There is a low realization for sales by the farmers. Profitability is low. Then macro level concerns are national food security, environmental concern, and sustainable agricultural intensification. When I say sustainable agricultural intensification, we are talking of genetic intensification, ecological intensification, and socio-economic intensification. That means we have to use our diversity, we have to use our ecosystem services, we have to use our, say what you call, natural resources in such a manner that we will not erode them, and biodiversity is enhanced, and at the same time we provide safe, healthy and nutritious food to the consumers and returns to our farmers. So food safety and nutritional aspects are also very important today, since now there is a strong connection after the pandemic between agriculture and the food which consumers are purchasing in the markets. Next. Now this is the total network what we have in the country as on today. We have about ICAR institutes about 101, which includes directorates, national Indian institutes, research centers, you name it. And then we have about 63 agricultural universities, which are state agricultural universities. We have central universities with agricultural faculty about 4, like BHU and Vishwabharati and so on and so forth. We have ICAR Deemuttubu universities about 4. Central agricultural universities, we have about 3. So basically in the country, we have 3 levels of agriculture research network. One is CJAR, which is consultative group for international agricultural research. Concerning that group, we have one international institute located in Hyderabad, what we call it as ICRISAT, that takes care of the global level research, education and so on and so forth. Then we have at the national level, that is the apex body ICAR, with its research institutes which take care of the research and also quality of education. Then we have at the state level, state agricultural universities, which take care of the, say what called local within the state research, teaching and extension activities. So we have these 3 levels, according to which we have a strong collaboration between these 3 in solving the agricultural challenges in the country. This is the issue why we are here today. Now, when we have such challenges, and when we have disruptive technologies, say what call impacting every aspect of our life, and let me share you in a lighter vein. Today, it is commonly said that internet knows more about us than our spouse. Okay, so most of, say what you call our, what we are doing, how we are working, and all that is known by internet, but not household, our wife or spouse. So in such a era we are living, we started with industry machine revolution, then we started with say what you call we have reached a stage of internet revolution today. So how IT can be leveraged in enhancing or say what you call addressing the challenges of agriculture. So there is an information pandemic today, research scientists. So you go to Google, you have million papers, you click there, you have million papers. But the issue is how authentic that information is, how reliable that information is, how I say, for example, there are many research stations located in three tier cities, what access they have, whether it is possible to have access to all these. So if somebody wants to really do data mining, how they can have the reliable, most trustworthy information. So remotely working scientists, remote colleges have really a tremendous challenge today. And sometimes the researchers we are seeing here, so we are bringing a great change in our knowledge management center. Earlier, which we used to call it as a university library, now there is a need that these centers, knowledge management centers, go to the stakeholders. Rather than stakeholders coming to the KMCs, they have to go to the researchers located in three tier cities, research centers, and there is a need for providing reliable information. So there is a need for classification. We know that there is an implicit information, explicit information. And here let me tell you, in my perception, there are four levels of this data. I mean, one is data which we normally conduct experiments and collect it. Then when we publish it, it becomes an information in a journal. Then somebody, when it reads it, it becomes a knowledge for him. And when he applies that knowledge at the field level, then it becomes a technology. So these are the things which we have to look at now in this era of internet. Then challenges faced by today is with regards to, as I was telling, that holistic information, relevant information. Where to find it, who will provide it, so what are the platforms available, so what is the search mechanism tool I have today, so that I can cater to this to the people who are in need of this information. This is the major challenge what we have today. Now this is where the institutions have to change. They have to bring in, leverage these technologies, information and knowledge that is being generated worldwide, how I can bring it to a single platform so that the institutions can use it or classify it as per the needs of the researchers. What is the type of keywords, metadata? We are talking of interoperability issues, storage, capturing, storage, processing it. We have images, we have scientific data, we have data generated today by mobiles, data generated by satellites, data generated by advanced remote sensing and geographical information systems, data generated by sensors. So all this data needs to be put on a single platform, so that the vendors, the service providers, the stakeholders, the farmers, the scientists can use it and benefit from it. Today we see various research platforms are being constructed, but one single challenge what we have is we are not building a ecosystem which actually addresses the agricultural challenges. We are trying to copy something from other sectors. This is where we need to have our own platform to meet our own needs, our own challenges. So that is where whether it is farmers, researchers, or NGOs, or consultants who are facing a big problem, probably we have to look at a dedicated platform for this. I think that is where the CABI and EBSCO has come forward to address this issue. Now, what are the benefits we have here? Now it is very clear that single search for all resources, then search functionality either by publication, database. That means as per your need, you can look at it. Then ability to search, we have several sources. Retrieve the results from non-journal content, e-books, patents, conference papers, reports, say what you call other, then it can be customized. Then say what you call, it should have capability of different themes and subjects that we have in agriculture. Then data analytics, today it is possible. So millions of say what you call bytes of data can be analyzed in a very short time. And so that informed decisions can be made. So meta-analysis is possible. So all these, say what you call, when you have at on a single search, then this makes easier for the people to look at and solve their problems. Now, here you can see, now today we are, say what you call, this university is trying to address the agricultural challenges which I have mentioned in the beginning, at the outset. So we are trying to transform the agriculture today. Now, wherein we are trying to build a platform wherein all this data is stored, and then using the artificial intelligence, big data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, you name it. So all this can be used and converted that knowledge into a informed decision so that smart delivery and control can be done. So now here you can see an example how the transformation has taken place from a product to a smart product, then smart connected product, then entire product system, wherein we have, say what we call, say systems of systems. So all this onto one platform, which can be looked at how farmer can benefit from this transformation of agriculture. So you can see in the last two decades or so, how things have changed from single product to a system of systems, wherein the stakeholders can benefit in a big way, wherein you can see the weather data, seed optimization systems, irrigation systems, like that fertigation systems, farm equipment. So all this data combined together, big data analytics can help us in taking or arriving at a very informed decision so that we can produce more without deteriorating our ecosystem. Now here you can see, I tried to put before you the map of technologies and their maturity. Now you can see you can produce differently using new techniques like hydroponics, aquaponics, aeroponics, you have algae feedstock, desert agriculture, seawater farming. Then you can use the new technologies to bring into the consumers in the agri-food system value chain. Say you now today it is possible to raise crops in the urban areas. You need not have a big farm. If within your own small area, you can raise the crops vertically. Genetic modification, cultured meat, 3D, 4D printing is make it possible to bring into the consumers, say what you call, as they like, keeping in view the environment. Then you have, say what you call, cross-sectoral industry techniques and field of like drone technology, data analytics, nanotechnology, blockchain to address the traceability of the product. Then crowd farming, wherein direct B2C, say what you call, you can take the product, so wherein, say it is possible. Then precision agriculture for smart delivery and control. So today, these are all these technologies are available, but readiness to grow to the market is varying among these. So some are in the advanced stage, some are in the validation stage, some are in the ideation stage, and so on and so forth. This is where you can see how data-driven decision-making can help the say what you call farmers and as well as the policymakers to take decisions. So descriptive and diagnostic analysis using the information can provide us what happened, and real-time analytics using the sensors, using the drones, you can know what is happening. Then based upon that, you can predictive information or say what you call decisions. Then that can go to a say, stage wherein what should happen in a prescriptive manner. You can optimize the inputs. You can optimize the production system. You can meet the consumer needs. You can say what you call enhance the efficiency of the production system. So this is very, very important, say what you call, in today's agriculture. Unless these analytics are incorporated based upon the scientific and research data, I'm afraid that agriculture cannot become an agribusiness enterprise. Then these are all the today technology is impacting every aspect of our agri-food chain. Here you have several technological solutions, but the most important challenge is how to take these solutions at a scalable level. So that is where we are stuck up today, and we are trying to say what you call bring in such transformation in agriculture by taking these robots, automation, say what you call artificial neural networks, crop health monitoring due to drones, satellites, when to sow, what to sow, analyzing the weather data, optimizing the inputs. So using the web and mobile apps to linking the farmers to the markets, price forecasting. So all these things are today, so data can make chairs, bring in this transformation, but scaling them is an important aspect. That is where the researchers, the say what you call the farmers, the other stakeholders can combine together. And let me share you that no single person or no single technology can solve the problem in the agri-food chain. Now they have to be a cooperation and a competition. So different challenges in the agri-food chain have to be addressed by different agri startups and so on. So these are the knowledge avenues what we have today. You take Sera Consortium, Google Scholar, Krishi Gyan Sindhu, Open Access Journals, to name a few. There are many other things and which we have to look at. So in view of the paucity of time, I will move forward very quickly. Next, now you can see a simple example given here. You can start submitting a query. So wherein you can see it goes to the knowledge depository, which wherein you have a platform. Then if your answer is found, then whether it is satisfactory for you, there ends the interaction. But if the query hasn't answered you satisfactorily, then you can refine and resubmit the query. Then it will search in the knowledge depository again. Then it say what you call sends it to the experts. Experts, if he is unable to answer, then he will go to the other experts. Then if the answer is found satisfactory, then say what you call direct user to specialize the discussion boards, then create knowledge, so on so forth. Now this is how knowledge platforms have to work and enable the answers to the challenges we are facing. So opportunities, tremendous opportunities we have today. So due to the access to the resources, you can optimize the entire production system, you can optimize the inputs, you can bring down the production costs, you can provide a lot of insights, agronomic insights into the for the stakeholders, you can link the farmers to the markets, you can know the say what called where the product has been produced, what is the traceability aspects. So you can deliver say what you call safe, healthy and nutritious agricultural commodities to the say what you call consumers. So the well-being of the consumers can be addressed. So these are all the say what you call opportunities what we have, and I think this is how we have to look at today the knowledge, the platforms and the say what you call information that is being generated and how it can be used for enhancing the say what you call agri-food value chain system in its entirety. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.